word, we're going to call your attention to the book of 2 Corinthians.
Right.
2 Corinthians 1. 2 Corinthians 1, and we will read verses 18 through 20. 18 through 20. 2 Corinthians 2nd, I'm sorry, first chapter, verses 18 through 20. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
And from the New Revised Standard Version, we read, "As surely as God is faithful, our word to you has not been yes and no. For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, whom we proclaim among you, Silvanus and Timothy and I, was not yes and no, but in him it is always yes." Verse 20, "For in him every one of God's promises is a yes. For this reason it is through him that we say the amen to the glory of God."
Yeah, right.
"For this reason, it is through him that we say the amen to the glory of God." Praise be to God for the reading of this word. Hold up those Bibles. This is God's word.
This is God's word.
I receive it.
I receive it.
I believe it.
I believe it.
I decree it.
I decree it.
God's word.
God's word.
Lamp unto my feet.
Lamp unto my feet.
Light unto my path.
Light unto my path.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated in the presence of God and the ushers. For this reason, it is through him that we say the amen to the glory of God. That's verse 20, part B. That we say the amen to the glory of God. In just a few minutes today, I want to challenge you as the choir has challenged us through music and through the work, the ministry of song. I want to challenge you with this question. Can the church say amen?
All right.
Can the church say amen?
All right.
Can you say amen?
Can you say amen?
Look at your neighbors and ask them, can you say amen?
Amen.
Because the bottom line is, whatever you're going through, whatever challenge you face, if you learn how to say amen, God will bless you.
Yes,
amen.
Amen.
This scripture is seemingly tucked away in this first chapter of the book of 2 Corinthians. I came across it and it immediately arrested my attention because, as you recall, on 2 weeks ago, we talked about the wilderness experience. And lastly, we challenged our leaders and the rest of the church that we can take possession of our promised land. Amen?
Right.
And you recall that I suggested that when you are going through the wilderness, that when you are between promise and fulfillment, that when you are in your downtime, that it's important for you not to give up on the promises of God.
All right.
Although it may appear that God has deserted you, although it may appear that you are all alone, that in the wilderness, as the late great E.K. Bailey once said, sometimes you want to trust God, but there is no trace of
Him.
You don't know what to do. But in that time, it's important that you not give up on the promises of God. Because guess what, church? God's promises are still activated in the wilderness. No, you may not be making the kind of money that you want, but His promises are still good. You may be faced with a dire health situation, on his promises are still good.
Yeah.
The children may have gone astray and arrived. Guess what? His promises are still good.
That's right.
So we have to be careful about slandering God's promises during our wilderness experience.
Yes, sir.
Exactly when the 10 spies came back and said they had been to the land, the promised land that God had already given them. And they came back and they said, we cannot take on this responsibility. In other words, what they were saying is, this blessing is too big for us to handle.
Right.
Have you ever been there?
Yes.
Have you ever felt that God was getting ready to bless you?
All right, preacher.
And it was too big of a blessing?
Yeah.
In that way, we slander God's promises. So in this chapter, during my daily reading, I came across this this amazing testimony by Paul.
All right.
And he's being quite frank in his writing here to the church at Corinth, and he is sharing with them, with his readers, that he had been severely persecuted in Asia, and that it was his intention to visit them in Corinth, but because of this persecution, which had nearly cost him his life. I mean, he was despairing of his life. He doesn't give any details here, but he writes that in his mind, the circumstances were so severe that he felt as if it were a death penalty.
All right.
That he had been sentenced to die. And it was an amazing testimony because it parallels what we go through in our modern day witness, Christian witness, when we come against our rough times, when we are, as the song says, climbing the rough side of the mountain.
Yeah.
The rough side of the mountain. You remember Dr. Mangum used to say, well, of course there's a rough side of the mountain. I've never heard of a smooth side of the mountain. So the mountain is going to be rough all the way around. But some of us have come across, or we are coming up on the rough side of the mountain. And we are tempted to give in and give up.
All right.
But Paul writes in this second letter here that such is not the case with him. He talks about the amen. And when you look at the word amen, and we are so accustomed to saying amen during worship that we sometimes take for granted what it actually means. Because the word amen is simply so be it. You are agreeing with the truth. You are agreeing with God's word. When you say amen, you are saying to God, so be it. And so God is the amen of our lives. God is the yes of our lives. He is not a yes and no God. You know, he's not shaky like that.
All right.
You ever know somebody be kind of shaky every time you ask them something? And you get both sides. You know somebody like that? You never get a direct answer. It's always it's always the response that leaves you feeling like your brother's kind of shaky. But not so with God. God is the yes. God is the amen of our lives. God breathes the amen into our existence. Because you understand that on the flip side of amen is the fact that the enemy is always working to rob us of our amens. It is the enemy's job to cast doubt on the promises of God. It is the enemy's job to make us believe that God has indeed abandoned us.
All right.
It is the enemy's job to, number one, attack our personal belief.
Yeah.
That's why the enemy wants to isolate you. He wants to get you where he can attack you person to person.
Yeah.
One of my preoccupations, so to speak, is the fact that so many of us in our community have given up on going to church.
Yeah.
And so many of us have decided that we are too big or too good to go to church and receive the blessing of the Lord.
Yep.
Now you ask those same people what they do on any given Sunday, and you'll get a plethora of answers.
Right.
All of my friends that don't go to church, I'm all, what are you doing on Sunday?
Yeah, yeah.
What are you spending your Sunday? What are you doing? And I get various responses, but here's the point. The enemy knows how to isolate you, how to get you away from your source of strength, so that he can gradually and eventually wear you down. Did you know that 18% of African Americans, according to a recent poll, 18% of African Americans describe their religious affiliation as atheist, agnostic, or nothing in particular?
Wow.
And that 18% has gone up since 2007, when it was only 12%. So a lot of people are worshiping nothing in particular. And at the same time, parallel to that rise in this kind of abandonment is the fact that homelessness in our community is on the rise.
Yeah.
Did you not know? This blew my mind. That it used to be that the biggest category or the fastest growing suicide category in our community was for young men, black males, 15 to 24 years of age.
Right.
But guess what? That category has now been supplanted or replaced, and this is going to blow your mind. And guess how old the fastest growing suicide age group in our community is now? 5 to 11.
All right.
Blows your mind.
Close your mind.
So we see this increase in hopelessness and a decrease in church attendance. And if this is a 5 to 11 year old age group, these young people are not making decisions on their own. They are attached to a parent group. They are attached to a guardianship. And so it's the adults who are really pushing this trend. But the bottom line is, when we get away from what we believe, when the evil one isolates us, he knows how to rob us of our enemy. So my brothers and my sisters, let the church say amen. Let your amen be your life. Let your amen be your testimony. Let it be your witness. Let your amen be the first thing you say in the morning when you get up. Why don't you say it all day long? And then when you go to bed at night, just say amen. Amen. So be it.
Yeah.
Is what you're saying.
Yes, sir.
Would you say amen? Because the enemy also knows how to expose you to unbelieving environments.
Yes, sir.
Watch who your friends are.
Yes.
Watch who your five closest friends are. Birds of a feather, you flock together. And you have some unbelieving people in your social network. Guess what? You're going to be just like them at some point. Because if they are unbelieving, if they have no amen in their life, that's going to impact you at some point.
That's right.
Enemy knows how to plant seeds of doubt with a preoccupation on the success of others.
Yeah.
I like that. On the success of others. Back to the report of the spy.